All right, now we're joined by Stephanie Selt, who is here to tell us why we should not support Initiative 732. So go ahead with up to 5 minutes to tell us why.
So my name is Stephanie Selt, and I'm the Washington State Policy Coordinator for the Blue Green Alliance. We are a labor, environmental, and community partnership organization that's predicated on the idea that we need to kind of confront the myth that people must be for jobs or for the environment, and that they're somehow incompatible goals. And our work is all about trying to find the common ground where there are ways that we can confront these challenges and also support and create good jobs. And so climate policy is one of the areas where obviously we have a lot of focus. There's a lot to think about, obviously, and you know, the devil is often in the details, but we are very committed to recognizing the urgency of addressing climate change, and also recognizing that it needs to be confronted in particular ways that focus on minimizing harm to especially people who work in the fossil fuel industry and for low-income communities, and maximizing opportunity in terms of really taking advantage of the major shifts that we are confronted with when we're facing global climate change. And so we think that taking the right kind of climate policy action is very important, but we are not supporting Initiative 732. We make our decisions based on consensus, and some of our members, the co-chairs of our group are Jeff Johnson from Washington State Labor Council. They strongly oppose 732, and we have a lot of other member organizations who fall in various categories, many of which in kind of do not support categories. So that's where we ended up on that official position, but we have a lot of concerns that we're very happy to speak about. I brought copies, I hope everyone got one. We have developed some climate policy principles, and we also have a statement explaining our do not support position on 732. And so the main points that we make in the 732 statement focus on the budget implications and the fact that it's projected to have a negative impact on our state budget. There are obviously, we've been doing reading about this, a variety of ideas about how big that would be, but our belief is that it's taking us in the wrong direction in terms of the state budget. We also think that climate policy needs to invest in clean energy and the clean energy economy. It really needs to help us kickstart, especially sectors of the economy that are not necessarily going to be reached through just market mechanisms on their own, which is what just putting a price on carbon is kind of relying on. And we think that a climate policy really needs to take seriously issues related to equity and the just transition. So there are a lot of sectors, people who work in fossil fuel industry or fossil fuel dependent industries, a lot of low-income people who bear a lot of the costs of carbon, of climate change, as well as possibly increased costs related to increased energy and other materials. And we think that it's really important to take seriously the need to really invest in making sure that everyone is, that no one is left behind. And we worry that 732 does not make any of those sorts of investments, and it really has the potential to leave people on their own. And one of my favorite kind of mantras, I guess, in this space is that no person or community should be roadkill on the path to a better future. And if you don't invest a serious amount of money in taking care of people and providing a pathway to viable employment and a more equitable society in a clean energy economy, you're just leaving people on the side of the road. So, and it also, it's not listed on that form, but we really think viability is a huge issue. We've seen, you know, increasingly very mediocre to poor polling on the viability of 732, and we think that, you know, even however theoretically good a policy might be, if it's not going to win, then it's not going to do any good. So we're working with the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy to be kind of crafting a better policy. And I'll leave it there.
Sorry. Great. So now we'll do follow-up questions. We'll start with Sarah and then Summer.
So I think probably all the stakeholders of the ship as well as the Air Alliance agree that we need to reduce carbon emissions and we need to do so in the next 5 years, in the length of time. So if you're not in support of the initiative that's currently on the ballot to fight carbon emissions, why do you want to do the initiative?
Well, the Blue Green Alliance is a member of the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy. I don't know if people in this room are familiar with that body.
Yeah, I'm on the statewide advisory board for the Washington Conservation Voters, so I understand.
Great, okay.
I'm just asking about the urgency of doing it now.
I mean, essentially it was because 732 qualified for the ballot and didn't step down during negotiations that were held between leaders of both of those organizations. Indicating that the alliance was putting together a more viable proposal that was more likely to win, and having two on the ballot is guaranteeing votes to fail. So we thought that was not a good strategy. But the alliance has been working hard the entire time since then to try to put together the policy that hopefully is going to pass in the legislature or at the ballot in the very near future as soon as possible.
Okay.
But it was mainly a viability question.
What does that plan look like moving forward, considering the urgency?
A lot depends on the elections, frankly. A lot depends on whether 732 passes, on how the legislature looks next year. But I would say the most likely scenario is trying to pass that ballot in 2018. There's no firm decision, but that I would say is the most likely thing to happen.
Considering my government is having to get out to a vote in the House.
Right. Our legislature is making it very, very difficult to do the right thing, and that's unfortunate. It would be better if we could do it through the legislature, but neither Governor's Bill nor 732 has gone anywhere through that route so far. And unless you all are really successful in being part of changing that, it seems very unlikely that something's going to pass in the legislature.
Thank you.
Summer and then Joseph.
Can you talk about some of the other groups I know that have come out with a no on 732 position? Mm-hmm. I know I've heard that Sierra Club came out as no. Is that correct?
That's not correct. Okay. Sierra Club is also do not support. It's a fine dance for some organizations who have very split membership, but they're not supporting it. They won't be advocating for it. The Washington State Labor Council and a number of labor organizations around the state of Washington have all come out very strongly against 732. We work very closely with the United Steelworkers Union, who represent a lot of the potentially impacted workers in Washington, including in refineries, in the aluminum industry, in cement, and some of the pulp and paper sites, and they're all very concerned that a policy that puts a price on carbon but doesn't adequately look into the leakage risk for the energy intensive trade exposed industries that are at risk of having to move out of the state because of the policy, that's not looked at carefully enough in 732. It's too much of a blunt instrument, so there's a risk of those jobs and the industries and all of their emissions simply moving to another state, which is bad for our economy, and it's at least as bad, if not potentially worse, for carbon emissions. And there's no money available to help support any workers who did lose their jobs. So a lot of labor is very concerned for reasons like that. A lot of other sectors of the labor movement are concerned also about impacts on low-income communities. So there's a lot of folks within the labor community that are very strongly opposed. A lot of the major environmental organizations have ended up in a do not support position, which has, this has been a really interesting learning process, I think, for a lot of environmental organizations who've had to have very difficult conversations with their boards and with their memberships about, hey, we have actually a carbon price on the ballot, and it seems like what everyone's been waiting for, but actually it's not. It doesn't look likely to pass, it doesn't look likely to be effective enough, and they're having to make a very difficult argument that we need to do better.
Justin?
And there's a lot of community of color and low-income organizations that are probably, along with labor, some of the strongest opponents.
So the $1 billion revenue shortfall comes from the Office of financial management at the state level, right? Mm-hmm. And Sightline did an analysis that opposed that, and I was wondering if you could speak to the specifics as to why those are two different conclusions fiscally on the same bill.
I mean, I can give you a big, you know, somewhat layman's assessment of that because I'm not someone with a background in fiscal analysis of that sort, but I know that all of these kinds of assessments have a lot of assumptions built into them, and so I know that some of the assumptions that Sightline has made are ones that are being questioned and are going to be rebutted by a number of organizations if they haven't been already. You know, one of them being that they assume that a lot of these energy-intensive industries in the state are going to invest heavily in clean energy technology and reducing their carbon emissions instead of just paying the fee or moving out of state. And I think you know, that's a big assumption. It's not necessarily clear that there are enough tools available or that are kind of close enough to being available that they're going to provide a path to lowering emissions and reducing their financial burden that's going to help help in that way. And I think most of the time the Office of Energy Management's numbers are, you know, the ones that people look to and are generally trusted, so I would take their word for it over mine. Or anyone, you know, any kind of layman, you know, they normally are able to make those sorts of judgments, but in terms of a technical assessment, I can't answer it exactly. But I know that there will be other rebuttals of that argument by Sightline that are being worked on.
So, is the Alliance's, I know the plan isn't announced yet, and maybe 2018, but is it a cap and trade based plan? And if so, can you sort of compare and contrast the, you may know the difference, but can you make the argument for cap and trade over a carbon tax? Or is it too soon?
Sorry?
Or is it too soon to say that it's going to be a cap and trade plan?
It's unlikely to be a cap and trade model of the sort that you see in places like California. It's the Alliance has been looking into improving on some of the existing models out there. So we're looking neither at a strict tax nor a traditional cap and trade model. And a lot of our policy development process has been based on trying to really build the concerns of a lot of the member organizations who have been looking at the impacts from other carbon prices around the world and trying to learn from them. And so cap and trade has been halted in a lot of cases for having left for many things, but a number of them being if they have a lot of offsets or the ability, you know, banking and borrowing from the future. These kinds of things have tended to mean that some of the sectors are able to continue emitting and end up sort of further polluting in particular areas, and the air quality in particular matter are things that are having health impacts on low-income communities and, you know, regions around there. So those sorts of pieces of cap and trade traditionally would hope to be left out. So what we're looking at are a couple of different options that would include a cap that would be stronger than just the price signal that comes with the tax, but would not include out-of-state trading. So it could be an in-state cap and auction system with investments, or it could be a fee that has that would increase more strongly depending on whether you're hitting your state cap or not, which would be science-based limits. So there's still some analysis going on in that department, but there's really a strong interest in making the best possible model and learning from past laws.
Thank you. Marion and Clay.
My impression is that the proponents don't present their initiative as the final answer, that if it passed, there could be other programs, there could be a program to encourage investment in green energy, there could be programs to retrain workers, that getting at the as mention of urgency. That's pretty urgent in 2018, it's 2 years away. Mm-hmm. That's part of my question, and the other question is, what are the other organizations besides the labor, Jeff Johnson, what are the other organizations that are part of the alliance?
Okay, a couple of questions. I think that 732 supporters and the members of the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy would very much agree that there's a whole suite of policies that are going to be necessary, and you're not going to solve all of these problems with a single policy. Mm-hmm. However, it's really important to do as well as you can, I think, the first time around, given especially the fact that if you pass something on the ballot, then improvements are going to need to go through the legislature. And again, kind of going back to that same comment, that it's very, very difficult to get the kinds of things that that we care about passed through the legislature, that it's somewhat, I would say, naive to kind of just pass the buck and hope that that will, those improvements will be made later. And I think there's, you know, on the nature of urgency, it's kind of related here, but Washington's emissions are reasonably small in comparison to other places around the world. But we have the ability to set a new model. We have the ability to present a package that addresses, that you know has strict limits, that is going to be effective, but is also really looking at some of these equity issues in terms of impacts on low-income workers, in terms of a just transition for fossil fuel industry workers, and building something that is going to be a model that other people can use in other places around the world. That means we're going to have better, more effective climate policies that also help us address some of these major social and economic inequalities that that are such a strong problem. We feel that if we don't address these things together, we just recreate the society that we have now with all of its flaws, and there's such an opportunity to do more than that.
In 2 years.
Well, we have such an opportunity to do more than that by passing the right policy, and if that's our first opportunity, that's our first opportunity.
What are the other organizations that are part of the alliance?
I mean, there's 150 or more. Okay. You can look on the website, but the kind of principal ones include some. I mean, do you want me to list them or
just a few samples?
I mean, Washington Environmental Council, Washington Conservation Voters, the Nature Conservancy, Sierra Club, the Washington Federation of State Employees, State Labor Council, the Green Alliance, Peterson Sage, and a number of
just one of the samples.
Yes.
No idea.
And there's so many more. I'm doing a presentation with Cool Mom, which is a generational parent climate group mm-hmm. later this week. There's some health organizations, Washington Physicians for Social Responsibility. There's a whole lot, and that's mm-hmm. part of the plan really for viability, is that you need to end up with a policy where you have only the fossil fuel industry opposed to you and everyone else in favor. That's mm-hmm. That's part of the model.
All right, Clayton.
I wanted to try to question the term of art that you used earlier, namely timeline, with respect to its relevance to 732. I read somewhere a long time ago that the mean elevation of Florida above the average elevation for above mean high tide is 4 feet. Mm-hmm. We saw in the New York Times this week a compelling photograph of a road in Florida underwater. So we know about the unit of air around the earth. So are we engaging in a kind of monumental complacency in using a term like a timeline? I mean, do we in fact have a timeline?
I'm not sure.
Or do we have yesterday?
So we're almost out of time, so why don't we take maybe just a minute to respond to Clayton's philosophical question.
I mean, I totally agree with you on the urgency. But again, I think it's important to set a model. A lot of the rest of the world does not have a price on carbon yet and does not have found a solution. If the solution was easy, we would have found it yesterday. But just bringing up Florida reminded me that I was at the the U.S. Climate Action Network conference a few months ago, and they were talking about equity and climate impacts there and how traditionally richer people have lived by the sea and poorer people have lived in the hillsides. And now the water is coming in and all the richer people are moving into the hillsides very quietly, pushing up the property prices. And where are the poorer people going to go there? I don't know. But these are the kinds of things that motivate me to really think about the equity impacts of the policy that you put together.
All right, so we're about out of time. If you want to take 30 seconds for a closing statement.
I guess I will just close in saying that the Blue-Green Alliance is very supportive of the idea that we do urgently need to take action on climate. However, there are better and worse ways to do that. We think that the Alliance for Jobs and Clean Energy is building something that is going to be much bigger, much better, and much more comprehensive, and is really going to address a lot of inequities in our society, as well as being a more effective tool for addressing carbon reduction. And we don't think that 732 is the way to go.
Great. Thank you very much.